This conference will now be recorded.
Yep, guys. So come up with your points. What is the rule? So if you remember in my beginning classes, that is demo classes, I was telling you PRPC is a form-based development process, right? So if you wanted to develop PRPC application, so far what we have did was we have opened certain forms and we have configured those forms. Say for example, we have created a property. How did we create a property? We have opened property rule form and we have given label of the property, type of the property, control of the property, and we have saved it, and we have given class of the property in which class this property has to be created, and we have saved it. Once it is saved, property is created. Similarly, we have created an activity. So we went to technical category from the class, we did a right click, we went to technical category, and from the technical category we have selected activity. Once we selected activity, a form has populated to us. Once the form is populated, we have given the activity name and we have clicked on create and open. Once we click on create and open, what happens? It has opened activity form. So what is a form now? If I wanted to, let's take example as property and we'll try to understand what is the rule. So now I did a right click. So I went to data model category and I try to click on a property. So once I click on property, what happened? Property rule form is populated for me. Now I'll give some name. So applies to classes work class, rule set is ensure core, and rule set version is the latest version, that is 010101-02. I've selected this. So what is this? This is a form, a UI form. Right, so as this is creating property, we are calling this as property rule form, right? So if I try to open activity, it will open activity rule form. Now I have created property, right? It has populated property rule form. Now where this is coming and what we are actually trying to do in the background, Once I click on create and open, what happens? A property is created. Once I click on create and open, see there are few things to configure on this property rule form. And if I click on save, what happens in the background? A rule is created, right? A rule has created with label demo prop 1. A rule has created. Now what is this something which is happening in the background, that is called as a rule. Now tell me what happened in the background once I create save.
It creates an instance.
It has created an instance in the database. In the sense, in one of the tables, in PRPC tables, it has created a row. So what is that table?
It is the table where the instance of the properties is there. Mm-hmm. Rules, okay. Objet, property.
It is rule, objet, property. So once we create a property, it means that we are creating an instance for one of the classes which is already there in the PRPC. So I have created a property and that property has created an instance for which class? The instance class of the property. What is the instance class of the property? It is rule obj property. Once you click on this, you'll get all the instances of this particular rule obj property. Yes. So if you see on the top, what is this? Demo prop 1. It was just created. Demo prop 1 is an instance of rule obj property. Now let's open the definition of this particular rule obj property class. So click on the definition. Once you click on the definition, you'll get the definition rule form. So obviously this class is a concrete class, right? We are creating an instance for this particular class. So obviously no question about it, it is a concrete class, right? Next. So it is the version. So it has some version, latest version, and this does not belong to a class group. Okay, what's the table associated for this particular class? So let's click on test connection and we'll see. What is that? It is rules.pr4_rule_property is the table which is associated with rule obj property class. Now, as soon as the property is created by the user, it has created an instance or a row in this particular table. Once we create a rule, so it is nothing but it is creating an instance of one of the instance classes which is already there in PRPC. If I create a property, it is nothing but we are creating an instance for rule obj property. If I create an activity, it is nothing but we are creating an instance for rule obj activity. If I create a flow, rule obj flow. If I create a section, it is rule HTML section. Okay, so all these are different kinds of rules which are there in PRPC. Now, having said this, can you define what is a rule? Basic thing, very, very, very basic thing.
Then rule is just an instance in the class.
It is an instance of a class. Is it a class? See, let's try to understand this. We have work class, right? We have work class. We have created many instances for our work class. Work class instances are called rules. If I create an instance for work class, is it equivalent to creating a rule? So, for example, I've created work object one. Is work object one is a rule or not? No, it is not a rule. We haven't created a rule. So, what is a rule in the sense? It is not an instance of a class. It is instance of an instance class. Whenever I create an instance for, or when I create an object for instance classes, then only it is called as a rule. For every class, see, there are n number of concrete classes. So for all those concrete classes, we can create instances. All those instances are not called rules. They are not called Pega rules. Only for the instance classes, we are calling it as Pega rules. Now, let's open the rule is an instance of instance class. It's an object of instance class, okay? Now, I think it was wrongly given, and rules get stored into table which are mapped to instance classes, right? See, the second point says rules get stored into table which are mapped into instance classes. In PRPC, instance classes will have mapping with database tables. So pxobj class holds the instance class name of a rule. Yes. pxobj class will hold the instance class name of a rule. Okay, so now here, apart from rule, we should understand a number of things. The first point is, you should remember most of the commonly used instance classes rules, like property. Property is a common one which we always create. Activity, section, flow action. So there are a number of rule types, right? So for all those rule types, we have to remember instance classes. Okay. Now I'll ask you one of the instance classes. So data transform. What is an instance class of data transform? Hmm?
Is it rule obj data transform or not?
Rule obj data modeler.
Rule obj data modeler. No. I've told you this in our classes. Till PRPC 6, data transforms are called what?
I think data modeler. Data modeler.
Models. Till PRP 6 version, so the same data transforms are called as models. Now tell me what is instance class of a data transform?
Rule obj models.
Rule hyphen obj hyphen models. Okay, rule dash obj dash models. So now, in this way, you have to remember most of the rule types, instance classes. If it's a property, you have to remember that. So that it will be, if you speak in terms, when you are trying to clear an exam, right? If you speak in terms of more technical details, so the chances of getting a job or the chances of having knowledge on them is a bit more. So this is what about a rule is. And see here, one more thing. So for all the instance classes, we'll have a table associated, right? See, we are creating a rule in the sense, we are creating an instance for one of the classes, that is instance class. All these instance classes are concrete class because we are creating rules. And if you see here, rule obj property is mapped to a table called as rules dash. I'm sorry, rules dot. So every instance class will start with rules dot. What is rules here? What is rules?
Maybe database name.
Yes, it is the name of the database in PRPC. Database in PRPC. Now let's try to open the database, the databases which are there for this particular system. Okay, so now I'll go to records. Your database comes under sysadmin category. Okay, now see here, under sysadmin category we have database option. Click on this database option. See here, how many databases are there?
Four
databases. Okay, there is something called as Pega rules. I'm opening this Pega rules. Okay, so test connection. So your PRPC has connected to four databases. One is external EXT database, another one is customer data, next one is Pega data, next one is Pega rules. So Pega rules is the name of the database where all your instance class related tables are stored. So if you take in PRPC 4 or 5 version, so everything is a single database. That is Pega rules database. Everything is a single database. Now in Pega 7, from Pega 7 onwards, they have separated the database. Rules versus the data. Rules versus the data. So all your rules, okay, all your rules, instance class rules are separated into Pega rules, and all your data instances are separated into Pega data. That is, it will, Pega data will start with the data dot, rules will start with rules dot. So that's the difference. So all your instance classes, that is all your rules, will store in Pega rules database.
So rules means, Karthik, like for example, if I create a new section, if I create a new activity, all this information storing in Pega rules. For example,
Pega rules database.
Yeah, when we run the flow, insurance flow, for example, if I give the any customer information, that record is stored in the Pega data.
Yes. So let me open this. I'll show you. So let me open various classes and let me show you. So this is our work class. So to which database it is pointing to our work class?
Data.
Data dot.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Let's open some states class.
Mm-hmm.
Right click and open the definition of this. What is this?
Data dot.
Yes. So your Pega rules versus the Pega data. All your work class, okay? And mm-hmm. your data classes. So what is data type here? Data type is a table which is getting created, right?
Yes.
So the tables, the user tables which we create, comes under mm-hmm. Pega rules or Pega data?
Pega data.
So it is Pega data. It is not Pega rules. Pega rules is something which is very, very core to the product. So it is nothing but rules, what rule instances versus the data instances. To separate them, so uh-huh. they have maintaining two separate databases.
Okay.
This happened in ERPC 7 version. Earlier it was one database only.
For example, we create the sections, right?
Yes.
For this states class, we create the, I mean, in section, we call the, I mean, we assign this property to the drop down. So
yeah.
I want to know, like, the section is pointing to rules, I mean, loading to into the rules database or data.
So you wanted to know when we create a section,
uh-huh.
so that section is created in which type of database, that is
yes.
rule
yes.
database or data database, right?
Yeah.
So if I create a section,
mm-hmm.
so what is happening in the background? So to which class it creates an instance?
In work class?
No. See, that's what I'll okay, come okay. to that point.
Okay.
So if I create
rule dash obj dash html.
Rule dash html dash it is section. This is the class. Instance class.
Mm-hmm.
So let me open this. Now, is it a rule class? It starts with a rule dash.
Yes.
It is one of the instance classes, right?
Yes.
It is one of the instance class. So it is specific to a section.
Rule. Yeah.
So now tell me whether it will point to rule dot or data dot.
I mean, I am sure, it's the rule dot.
Okay. Let's see this. So click on test. To which it is pointing to?
Rules.
Okay. So now, this section, if I create a section in the class, in my work class,
uh-huh.
okay. expand user interface. Section address details section. This is section, right?
Yes.
So this section, to which class it is for, in which class it was created?
Work class.
It is created in work class. Okay.
Yeah.
So now the instance of rule HTML section is created in SBI Insure Cowork.
Yes.
We are creating an instance. That instance is created where? It is created in your work class.
Yes.
Okay. So it doesn't mean that you have created in this particular class. So the instance class of section is not the work class. Instance class of the section is rule HTML section. And yes, the created class is the work class.
Yes.
Okay. So now let's, what we'll do is, so this is a section which was created in SBI-insureco-work. See, from actions, okay, try to understand, guys. From actions, we have something called as view XML. Click on this. Okay. Control F. See here, how many instances rule HTML section we have find? We have 36 instances. Okay. So now see the first one. So what is this?
pzInsKey.
pzInsKey of what?
Section.
This section. Okay. We'll come back to this. Next one. So we'll go to various instances. Anyways, so this is what I tell you. I was telling you about PXINS name, instance name. So PXINS name, see, I'm copying this. See here, this is PXINS name. Instance name. So now what is the instance name here? So instance name gives in which class this particular rule was created. Instance name will give you in which class this particular rule was created. Now what is this? So what is the first part? There are actually two parts in this particular PXINS name. So what is this? I'll separate out. Okay.
One is, so the highlighted one is the class name and the other one is the section name.
Yes, it is the section name. The highlighted portion is
section name.
Okay. That is the name of the rule. That is the name of the rule that we have created. And what is this? The second highlighted portion.
That is the work class.
That is the work class or the rule in which we have created this section.
Yes.
The rule in which we have created this particular section. And these are separated with what?
Exclamatory.
With an exclamatory mark. Okay. So to differentiate between class name and the rule name, so it was separated with some exclamatory symbol. So this is the structure of your pzins name. Okay. Now, so your pzins name will give you the information about the rule in which this particular class, this particular rule was created. So in real time, so when you are working with, if you wanted to know the class in which it is created, then you have to access pzins name. Now, pxobj class. So if you take pxobj class, see here. What is pxobj class here?
Rule HTML section.
Yes. Pxobj class contains the instance class of this particular rule. PxObj class is a property, so which holds the instance class of your property. PxIns name will hold the class, the created class, the property in which it is created, the rule in which it is created. So that information is stored in PxIns name. And let's come back to this one. Hello, everybody, you are following or not?
Yes.
What about others? Manoj, Prasanna, Swikar?
Yes.
Yes. So I'll repeat this. So whenever you create, so creating a rule in the sense, it is nothing but you are creating an instance for one of the instance classes which is already there in the system. If it is a property, we are creating an instance for rule obj property. If it is a section, we are creating an instance for rule HTML section. In this way, if you are creating a rule, it is nothing but you are creating an instance for one of the existing classes. Okay? And all those instances are stored in instance class related tables. Instance class related tables. Now, again, these rules are created in rules dash database. There are in Pega, so your database is classified into two types. One is rules database, another one is data database. So it is classified into two types. One is rules, other one is data. So why they have classified is because the for better management of the rules, to segregate, so all the rules they have brought into one database, all the data instances they have brought into another database. So to differentiate between rules versus the data, so they have segregated. So all your rules, all your whatever the rules that you create, right? So those comes into rules dash, rules dot. And if it is a data instance, it comes under data dash. Now I've opened one of the instance or one of the rule, that is section rule. In the section rule, I went into HTML of this particular rule. See this, for any rule, we have the generated XML. So that generated XML will give you lots of information about this particular rule. So in that, I'm seeing pxins name. Pxins name is the instance name. So in which class this particular instance is created, that information is stored in pxins name. Okay, so if you see this, so the pxins name, the structure is, it is the class in which is created and the name of the rule. Those two are separated with some exclamatory mark. So this is one. And pxobj class, so your pxobj class property will contain the instance class of this particular rule. Okay, so now what is this? The first one, rule HTML section. What is rule HTML section? It is instance class, right? Hello.
Yes.
It is rule instance class space. What is this?
Work class.
This is work class space. What is this?
Section name.
Yes, name of the section. What is this?
Maybe created date.
Created date and time. Yes, it is 2019-04-05. This is the date. Okay. And next one is timestamp 01-09-01-74. This is date and timestamp. Date and time. So now what is this? If you remember this one, instance class, yes, instance class space your work class space the name of the rule space the date and time stamp. So we call this as an instance class. Sorry, pzInsKey. I'm sorry, this is called as pzInsKey. So if you wanted to know the pzInsKey of your rule, what you have to do? One way is you have to go to that particular table, rule table, and you have to access the table, and you will get one of the columns as pzInsKey. From that particular pzInsKey, you can get the instance pzInsKey name. And the other one is open the XML which is generated for this particular rule and search with pzInsKey. This is pzInsKey.
So other than the XML, we need to go to the database, Karthik, to know the pzInsKey?
Yes.
Thank you.
So first, what happens is, all this, see, now tell me one more thing. Your XML is stored where? Where is your XML stored? Stored in the table only.
Yeah, they stored
all, yes, all your rules, everything. So whatever the rules, the properties that you are seeing in the database, right? It is not something normally it is stored in the way that we are seeing there. So it is converted to XML, and this XML is stored in the table. Okay. I'll repeat this. Whenever a rule, you have created one rule, something section rule. This section rule is created in a format called as XML format, the same XML format you are seeing now. This is a visual representation of the data which is stored in your table. Now tell me, why did we convert into XML? Why not we store it in the way it is, a normal English format? Why it has converted to XML format? Hello. What is one of the features of Pega? They are secured applications, right? So when I was speaking about the features of Pega, I was telling you, so Pega is, if you create an application in Pega, so by default, they have some of security mechanisms. So they are considered as a secured applications. Why they are considered secured applications? Because
first it created the Java.
No, Java is not. First it has, once we created this, so Java is, yes, generated Java is created. Okay, that is stored in the form of code. That's a different, that is another separate wing. Now I'm telling you how this rule data is stored. It is stored in the form of XML.
Okay.
See here, if you, this is pzInsKey. pzInsKey, it has to store in the table, right? This particular pzInsKey, the generated pzInsKey.
Yes.
So this is not a code. This is not the Java code which is generated. This is something that we have created. Okay. This rule information was stored in XML format. So generally XML have some tags that are embedded in start and end tags. See here, pzInsKey is the name of the field. Okay. So this is embedded in the rule start tag, that is pzInsKey and slash pzInsKey. These are the conventions of your XML format. Every XML data is stored in between XML tags, that is pzInsKey and slash pzInsKey are the XML tags in this case. So now this is the actual value which is there for this particular pzInsKey. So your date, your rule information is stored in the form of XML. Why it is stored in, why it has stored in the form of XML is to provide security mechanisms. The basic level security it is providing. So to just provide security, it has converted to XML format. And if you wanted to know the rule information, so open this XML, you'll get entire information about that particular rule. So if you have opened the section, right? So go to view XML and you will see all the properties which are associated for this particular XML. Okay. So here, this is py section type is standard, parameter set flag is false, py rule name is address detail section, updated system ID is Pega, something. Everything is stored in the XML. So if you wanted to see the XML, you can open and you can see. You'll get almost most of the information on this rule in this particular XML. Now, if you wanted to see it visually, instead of XML, if you wanted to see this same information visually, so how to see that? You have to open the clipboard. The clipboard is the UI representation of your XML data. Okay, any questions? Hello.
I'm good, Karthik.
Yeah. Now, I'll ask you one more thing. Yes. Yes, Manoj. Yes. Go ahead.
No, you can go ahead.
So, how many types of instances are there? Rule is nothing but instance of a class, one of the instance classes, right? How many types of instance classes are there? There are two types of instance classes. One is rule instances, other one is data instances. Do you remember this? Instance classes are classified into two types. One is rule instances and other one is data instances. Example of rule instances is rule obj property, rule obj flow, rule obj section, rule obj flow action. So all these are instance class, those are rule instances. Can you give me an example of a data instance?
Work class.
Is work class an instance class?
data dash operator ID.
Yeah, data dash admin dash operator hyphen ID. So that is data instance. Okay. Let me open that. If you create a prop, if you create an operator, so your operators are nothing but data instances. Another example of a data instance, access group. Access group is a data instance. So we'll open that particular class and we'll see that. I'll open the operator. Let's go to this. This is your data instance, that is instance class for your operators. So all your operators are stored in which class? This particular class. And the table which is associated for this particular class is very important in terms of your interview point of view. They'll ask you, they'll straightforward, they'll ask you, so in which table all your operators are stored? Okay. So click on definition. Click on test condition. So now tell me to which database it is pointing to. It is rules or is it data?
Data dot.
Data dot. It is not rules dot. All your rule instances are stored in which database? Rules, Pega rules database. All your data instances are stored in Pega data database. So your data instances are stored in Pega database. Pega data database. All your rule instances are stored in Pega rules database. That's the difference you have to understand. So PR underscore operators is the name of the table where it stores all your operators. Okay. Pega rules. PR underscore operators is the name of the table where it stores all your operators. So this is a direct question I've seen in a couple of companies where it asks all your operators are stored in which class, PR underscore operators. Okay. So now let's go to one more data dash admin dash. Sorry, operator hyphen access group. This is the instance class of your access group. Okay. Now let's do a right click on this. Click on the definition. PR underscore data underscore admin is the name of the table where your access groups are stored. So this comes under data dot, which means it is there in Pega data database. Now another question, how does this class knows that it has to point to this particular table? this is class. This is table. So this class is connected to this particular table. How? You got the question? This is also important in terms of your interview point of view. So there is a rule in the background. That rule will tell you which class has to point to which table. Hello. Okay, fine. So go to records. There is something called as database table rule. Okay. So click on this particular database table rule. So let's open one of the database table instances. Now see here. This is the name of the table to which this particular customer GIPC, this is the name of the class. This class is pointing to a table name called as PR underscore G underscore CPTL and insure underscore data underscore customer. This is the name of the table. This is the name of the class. This class is pointing to this particular table. This information is stored in database table rule. Hello. So the question here is, my simple question is, how does the class know that this class has to point to so and so table in the database? So there is a rule. There is a rule in the background. That rule is called as database table rule. Database table rule. This database table rule will tell you to this class should point to which table. So that thing I'm showing you here. So this is the name of the database table. See here, what is this? This is the name of the class. This class is pointing to which table? This is pointing to this table. Now you got this point?
Yes, we got it.
Yes.
Now I'll ask you one more question. Can I change the name of the table to which this particular class is pointing to? Now, instead of this class, so I'll give you some ABC table. Will it work?
I think yes.
It is yes or no. So first of all, let's understand like this. Can we change the table of a class? Is it possible or not first?
Because if you define the table in the database and if you are pointing to that table which is already defined, then yes, it is possible.
So the answer is yes, it is possible. You can change the table name of a class. So generally the question is something like this. So you have created your work class. So work class is already created by the system, right? Once we create an application, your work class is created. So the work class is associated with the work table. Table also is created for that particular work class. Now the question is something like this. Can I point all my business transactions? Okay, can I point all my business transactions, that is work related work objects, Can I point to a different table? Is the question. Yes, it is possible. How we can do that? So now you have to come to the database table rule, which is pointing the class and the table. Yes, as Shrikar has told that, so you have to create a table in the database. You have to create a table in the database. Is it only creating a database itself is fine, or the schema of that particular table should match or not? See, you have to create a table and you have to point the table to this particular class. Now this class, assume that this class has property 1, property 2 and property 3. So if it is holding, this class is holding 3 properties, assume in that way. Now if I create a table with property 1 column, only one column, and this class has 3 properties, so will it match?
No,
it will not match. It is not only creating a table, you have to create a table so that it should have matching schema in the sense. So whatever the class, how many properties it has, so that properties it has to match with the number of columns in the table. So if you create an appropriate schema and appropriate table, and if you point the table into this particular database table rule, yes, once you save, it will work. Now all the instances which you create now, that will go and it will store in the new table that you have created. Got this? So the question is like this. So I wanted to store all my business transactions into a separate table. The external, there is some external database. I wanted to point to that particular external database. Is it possible or not is the question. Yes, it is possible. So if it is an external database, you have to define that external database in the database table rule. And now once you open the database table rule, you have to point that particular class to that particular external database table. Once you point and save it, so whatever the new transactions that you create for your work class, those transactions will go and it will store in the new database. Okay.
Karthik, will it be done in real time, like changing the tables?
Yes. So most in real time scenarios, so most of the times they will not store it in the database that Pega gives, right? So work class is created, right? So work class is created. Let me show you that. I'll open the work class. So this is my work class, okay? So this is created during your application creation. And the associated table is also created during your application creation. Most of the times, they will not store in the default table that was created. They will create their own database, and in the database, they will store the table. Most of the scenarios, 70% of the scenarios, they'll store in the external database only, not the database which is given out of the box. Let's come back. So the first question is, what is the rule? So that thing we have discussed. So if they ask you what is the rule, so you should be in a position to tell at least five points about the rule. So what is the rule? You have to tell. A rule is nothing but it's an instance class. If you say in one word answer, so it is not worth. So it has lots of information to tell about what is the rule in PHP. You can tell 1 hour about a rule, and you can give a simple one statement also. Okay. So now that depends on you, how much information that you have on a rule. So you can start explaining about a rule. The same rule, we can discuss this rule in for complete day also. Then we can tell the same answer for this particular question in one word answer also. Now that depends on you. At least you should tell 5 important points, minimum 5. Okay. So now the way you have to answer this particular question is something like this. See, if you bring new points in this, if while you are answering this particular rule, you say one of the points like instances are divided into 2 types, rule instances and data instances. You have told one of the points in answering this particular question. Now immediately he will ask you, what is a data instance? You brought a new point, right? So if interviewer has some new things, new points in your answer, so he immediately will ask. So most of the times he'll ask that, what is that new point? So you said it is divided into data instances and role instances. Now he'll ask you, what's the difference? Definitely he'll be asking you. So you should decide. You should prepare that answer and you should go and you should tell the points. Don't bring new points into when you are answering a question, right? Don't bring new concepts. Say, for example, you have told pzInsKey. When you are answering this, you have brought one point, pzInsKey. Then definitely he'll ask you, what is pzInsKey? The structure of pzInsKey will ask you. So you should be ready with those answers. So if you're not ready with those answers, don't bring new points. When you are answering a question, don't bring new points into the picture. If you bring new concepts, right, he will ask you those concepts. Okay. Next. Shall I proceed to the next question? Now, do you have any questions on what is the rule?
Yeah, go ahead.
So the second question is, any rule in Pega that gets stored in rule base table will have unique primary key, that is pzInsKey. Okay. It says any rule in Pega that gets stored in rule database table will have unique primary key called as pzInsKey. Yeah. Let's discuss about pzInsKey and a couple of points. pzInsKey, what is pzInsKey?
It's a uniquely identify. Yes, through all the database.
Primary key of the table. It is a primary key of the table. What else? For a table, do we have one more key? We have class key also, right? Hello.
Yes.
We have class key and we have
the class key is uniquely identified inside the table, but it can be duplicated in other tables. But the pzInsKey, it's unique in all the database.
Yes, entire database it is unique. Guys, just give me 2 minutes, okay? So think about this. Just give me 2 minutes, I'll come back.
Okay, no problem.
Sorry, guys. Yeah. Any points on pzInsKey versus the class key? Now, who will generate this pzInsKey?
System.
It's a PRPC, the system.
System will generate on a particular format. So in terms of your interview, right, what they'll be asking is something like this. They'll ask you the definition of what is pzInsKey. So pzInsKey is actually, it's a name of the field. It is a name of the field. That is, it is a property. This property will hold the pzInsKey. So if you take any table, so there is something column called as pzInsKey. In that equivalent class, it has a property, pzInsKey property. This pzInsKey, it's a name of the property which will hold the pzInsKey. But this pzInsKey is called as an instance handler. So this is an instance handler. So this instance handler is stored in a property called as pzInsKey. So now they have corrupted this, and instead of asking instance handler, they'll ask you pzInsKey. Okay, pzInsKey. So actually pzInsKey is the name of the property which will hold the value of the pzInsKey. But so that pzInsKey is called as instance handler. Okay. So if you see in activity rules, right? So they'll not ask you for pzInsKey. What is the name of instance handler? They'll ask you something like that. So it is both the same. So before we speak about the structure of that particular pzInsKey, let's try to understand. So to which classes this is applicable? To which classes this is applicable? So if you remember, in our project, we have created something called a state table, right? Dot states. This is the table that we have created, right? So for this table, so what is the class key? It is state ID. Click on test connection. So this is the table which got created in the background. Now tell me, do we have pzInsKey column for this particular table? Do we have pzInsKey for the table that we have created, states table?
No.
No. No. What?
Like when you create instances for that table, then only pzInsKey gets created.
When we create instances for the table, then only it is created. We have created instances, right, for this particular table. We have created. Now let's see this. Let's click on states table. Let me open that database also. So it is opening the database. So pgadmin4, I'll show you. So once we open database, right? So system will become slow. So I'll explain the servers. So in the local host. And the table space. Pega rules. This is the database. Okay. These are the tables. So these are the tables. See here. In this Postgres, we have rules dot data dot. Okay, so this is data dot and this is rules dot. Now expand data, expand tables. Now let's see the states table. So what is the name of the states table? SBI underscore insured underscore data underscore database. Something. This is also one of the states table. Okay. Now let's click on this. Let's click view data, view all rows. See here, apart from state ID and state name that we have created, we have PX create date time on all those some updated properties. Okay. Apart from this, do we have pzInsKey for this particular table? Do you see any pzInsKey column? Hello.
No. Oh, no good.
No, we don't have. So then pzInsKey is applicable for which types of tables? Is it rules? Is it only for rules or is it only for both rules and data?
It's for both.
If it is for both, right, then it should, this should also have this data in this data database should also have pzInsKey, right? So now I'm bringing to a point where for which types of tables pzInsKey is applicable. I wanted to get an answer for which kind of tables pzInsKey is generated. See, this is system generated, we did not create it. So for which types of tables or for which type of class tables, so pzInsKey is generated. So that we are I'm trying to understand. See, one first point is for all your rules, for all your rule related tables, it will generate pzInsKey. It will generate pzInsKey. Now coming to data instances. So for which type of classes the data instances, or for which types of table in the data database, so pzInsKey is generated. See, for data types, what is the data type? The table which you have created, right? See, state is a table which is created by the user. See, if you wanted to create a table, you have to go to data type explorer and you have created a table, right? So for that tables, pzInsKey is not generated. For all user defined tables, there is no concept of pzInsKey. You have to go with only class key. Okay. Now let's go to data admin operator ID. So data admin operator ID is stored in which table? PR underscore operators is the name of the table in which all your operators are stored. Let's see. So this is PR underscore operators, right? So what is this table? This table will have all the operators in your system. So let's do a right click. Click on view data. Click on some view first 100 rows. So in this, can you see pzInsKey anywhere? See here. What is this? This is pzInsKey.
Yes.
Okay. So for pzInsKey, it is not something like, you cannot say a generic statement for all your data instances. There is no concept of pzInsKey. So it's not that. I'll tell you. So pzInsKey is applicable for all your rule types. In the sense, rules dot table. For all your rules, rule instances, that is rule obj, property rule obj, flow action rule obj section, for all your instance classes, pzInsKey is generated. Okay. For all your data instances, pzInsKey is applicable. Okay. For your work class, is it applicable or not? Yes, your pzInsKey is applicable for your work class also. Now coming to data types, that is user defined tables. So do we have concept of pzInsKey for user defined tables? Hello. No, you don't have. pzInsKey is not applicable for user defined tables. So this is the difference. So your pzInsKey is applicable for rule instances, data instances, and for your work class. But whereas coming to data types, that is user defined tables, pzInsKey is not applicable. So for all your data types, you should give a proper class key so that it will identify its own key. You got this? See, in the sense, if they ask you whether pzInsKey is applicable for data types, the answer is no. There is no such concept for all your data types in your PRPs. So it is applicable only for rule instances, data instances, and for your work class. Now coming to the structure, do you understand pzInsKey is applicable for which types of classes? It is for these types: rule instances, data instances, and work class. So now coming to the structure. So what is the structure of pzInsKey?
The name okay. of the rule.
Name.
Or first the class.
Okay. Then we'll derive this pzInsKey. Assume that you don't know the structure of your pzInsKey. Okay. You don't know the structure of pzInsKey. Now let's try to identify. I've created a property. Property with name prop one. Okay. Now let's derive instance class for this. pzInsKey for this particular property one. Okay. So now, what is pzInsKey? pzInsKey is something which you have to derive uniquely. So you have to identify this particular property uniquely in the database. Okay. Uniquely in the database. Now, if I give the pzInsKey as property 1. Now I have given the pzInsKey field as property 1. Will it work?
No.
Why it will not work? What's the reason?
I mean, we have to provide the instance class name and
okay, we'll come back to that. Okay, I know the structure. Okay, now assume that you don't know the structure of your pzInsKey. Okay, so now on the fly I given property 1 is my pzInsKey. Will it work or not? I'm telling you this property 1 is unique across the database.
Maybe it's working.
pzInsKey is unique. I'm giving that pzInsKey as property 1. Will it work or not? It will not work. It is not unique across the database, right? Because there might be other properties with same name property 1, right? So there might be a section name also. We can create a section name with property 1. Now if I search with this property 1, how many instances I will get?
2.
Two instances in the sense. So it is not unique one, right? See, PRPC will allow me to create same name with two different rule types. For property 1, I can create property 1. For section also, I can create property 1. The name can be same for two different rule types. So in order to differentiate property related things, so I'll embed instance class for this particular one. Instance class space property 1. So to differentiate between these two things, to get uniquely, I'm giving instance class with the name of the property. Will it work? See, so far with property 1, there are two instances. That is property 1 from the property 1 from the section also. We are getting two instances. To get single instance, to get only the property 1 of type properties, I'm giving instance class name. Now this is removed, right? You cannot get this. I'm telling you, instance class, go to rule obj property and get property 1. Now it will give me only property 1. It will not give me section related property 1. Now, will it suffice? Now see here, this property 1 is created in class A. Now the same property with name prop 1 I can create in class B also. Is it possible or not?
It's possible.
This is possible. Now if I search with instance class and property 1, how many instances I'll get?
Two
instances. I should not get two instances, right? I should get a single instance. Then how to differentiate between these two things? You have to provide the name of the class also, right? I'll embed this. Now tell me, in this example, how many instances it will give for me? See, instance class is rule obj property. Created class. Instance class is rule obj property. Okay, now it will go to property. It will search of type properties. And now created class is class A. Assume that I've given here class A. And now property 1. Will it give me one results or two results now?
One result
because I'm giving class A also here. If I give class A, it will give me this one. If I pass class B, it will give me this instance. So for that reason, we are giving instance class name, created class name, and name of the rule. Okay, next one. Assume that class A is inherited from class B. In this class also, there is something called as property one. Now class A has how many instances? Property one from the its own class and property one from its parent class. See, class A is a child class of class B. Assume that this is the structure. Okay, so now property one, it has an instance from class B and class A has its own property one. Now how will you define this? So in this example, if I pass this, how many instances I'll get? I'll get two instances. One is from the class A, another one is from the inherited class. Okay. Now how will you differentiate? I wanted to get this instance. Now how will you differentiate that?
Adding timestamp.
Having timestamp. Or within class A, assume that you have two rule sets. Rule set one and rule set two. So in this rule set one, you have property one. And in rule set two, you have property one. So within the same class, within the type property, this prop one, there are two rule sets. One is rule set one and rule set two. In both the rule set, you have property one. So in order to get it uniquely, so you need not to provide rule set name. For that reason, they have included timestamp. Okay, so now in this way, it is unique now. If you pass this, it is unique. Now if you provide timestamp, so whichever timestamp you provide, that instance you will get it. Okay, so this is how your pzInsKey is structured. Hello, any questions on this? Why we are providing all these things is because in order to file uniquely in the database, we are identifying the structure of the pzInsKey. So you have to remember this in terms of your interview point of view, right? So you have to, why we are providing instance class, why we are providing created class, and why we are providing a rule name and timestamp. So everything has got some meaning in the background. Okay. So have you understood this, the structure of pzInsKey?
Yes.
Others? Prasanna, Manoj, and Shrikar?
Yes.
So in interview, what they'll do is they'll ask you about what is pzInsKey, and they'll give you some, and also they'll tell you, so for which kind of rules or for which kind of tables your instance or pzInsKey is generated. They'll ask you this kind of question also. And finally, they'll give you an example. So they'll ask you to generate the pzInsKey. Then you have to tell this. And for sure, some people will ask you the structure of pzInsKey. So that's all about the pzInsKey structure. Okay. And another point. This thing, created class and the rule, name of the property, sorry, the name of the rule is nothing but your class key. That combination is class key. Okay. this way also you can define your pzInsKey. Let's proceed. So the third one is activities. Okay, so write a generic activity to update the label of any role in PRPC. Okay, so you have to do an OBJ. Okay, now let's for activity, there are good number of questions. It's a big list of questions we have on activity. So what we'll do is today we'll discuss on activities, some of the questions on activities, then we'll wind up for today. Okay, so once we'll discuss after activities, we wind up the session. Is that okay? It will take at least half an hour to 45 minutes. Is that okay?
Yeah, okay, no problem.
Okay. Now let's come back to activities. First of all, first question is, what is activity? Instance class for activity. Yes. So I was telling you right, so in the beginning of this session, let's keep this discussion as interactive as possible. So if you don't know what is an activity, so this is a basic thing in your application. So if you wanted to implement any kind of business logic, you have to write an activity. So this is the definition of activity. You should know this, right? Now tell me, what is an activity?
Creating, by using activity, we can create temporary pages.
Okay, that is one of the, by using activity, yes, we can create them. That is one of the features in activity. But in general,
some business logic.
Sorry? I'm sorry, Ahmad, can you repeat that?
I'm saying we use activity to create business logics.
Yes. So the primary reason why you are using is activity is in order to implement business logics in your application. If you wanted to implement any kind of business logic, you have to write activity. Example, you wanted to generate a transaction ID, you have to write an activity. Okay, so you wanted to calculate some value, you have to write an activity. So any kind of business logics, if you wanted to implement in your application, then you have to write activity. Okay, so that is the purpose of activity. So whenever they ask you what is activity in which way, so you have to start with activity is a rule type in PRPC. So these rule types are created in order to implement business logics in your application. So this is what the definition of an activity. Okay, so now what is an instance class?
OBJ activity.
Yes, it is rule dash OBJ dash activity is the instance class. Under which category this activity belongs to? What is the category of this activity? So category technical. In the sense, yes, it is technical category. Your activity comes under technical categories. Let's do a right click on this. So hover on create. So all these are category types. Your property comes under data model category. Your decision rules like when rule, decision table, decision tree comes under decision category. Similarly, activity comes under technical category. Okay. So these are basics. No one will ask you these questions. So they'll assume that you know all these things and they'll ask you on top of it. Okay. Next. What is the structure of your activity? How activity will look like? So if you open any activity rule, it has sequence of steps. right? So the structure of activities, it has sequence of steps and it's a sequential processing unit. An activity is a sequential processing unit in the sense, so if your activity has 10 steps, first it will execute step number one, it will go to step number two, it will go to step number three, it will go to step number four, and so on up to till the last step it will go, it will execute the last step and it will come out of the activity. Okay, it will come out of that particular activity. Okay, and so what's the best practice? See, do we have any limit for creating steps in here in an activity? Say for example, I've created 1,000 steps in activity. Is it possible to create 1,000 steps in PRPC for an activity rule? Can I create 1,000 steps in an activity? Yes, you can create. There is no limitation for creating steps in activity. You can create 1,000 steps also. So what's the best practice?
It is 25 steps is
the best practice that Pega systems suggest, because for maintenance purpose, for readability purpose, all those things, we are limiting our number of steps into 25. Okay, now there is something called as type of an activity. There is some, let me open the rule and I'll let me show you that. Go to technical category. Go to activity. Something browse states. So this is an activity rule, okay? And coming to the security tab, there is something called as activity type. So this is also important in terms of your interview point of view. They'll ask you, how will you define activity type? Based on what context you will define this particular activity type? How many types of activities you can create?
Utilities
here. There is a big list of types that you can create. Okay. Now, if I create an activity, I wanted to use this activity in my flow processing. Can I repeat this? I wanted to use this particular activity in my flow processing. Then type of this activity should be what?
Utility.
Why utility? Why not routing? So there is something called as, you're saying utility. I have to choose utility. Okay. Why not validate? Why it is utility? Because why we are calling this as utility? Because in the flow, if you wanted to run an activity, what is the smart shape which is supported? Sorry, not smart shape. What is the shape which is supported for calling an activity in your flow processing?
Assignment.
See, if I want, sorry, assignment. No, not assignment, definitely not. In by using assignment, can we execute an activity rule? No, that is not the case. See, if you wanted to run an activity as a part of your flow processing, so I'll do a right click and I'll hover on the shapes tell me which basic shape you will serve. Assignment, no. Decision, no. Subprocess, no. There is something called as utility shape. If you wanted to run an activity in terms of your flow, you have to call utility shape. You have to add utility shape. Open the properties of your utility shape properties. See here, rule. This rule is nothing but your activity rules. All these are activities. Okay, so you are using utility shape in order to call an activity rule. So for that reason, the type of that particular activity should be utility. For this, if you wanted to run an activity in your flow processing, so the supported shape is utility shape. By using utility shape, you can call the activity rule, and when in the flow, when once this utility shape comes into the picture, so it will run that particular activity. So as utility shape is supporting to run an activity, so we are calling this particular, the type of the activity as utility. Okay. Now, let's go to the activity rule. There are other types. See, the n number of companies will ask you about the type of the activity. This is very, very important. Though we will not use frequently in our real-time scenarios, but in terms of interview point of view, it is more important. See here, there is something called as validate. When will you use this validate type validate? If you wanted to use validation, rule obj validate and edit validate, there are two different types of validations, right? So if you are using a validation in your activity, then this type of activity should be a validate type. Okay. Now, on change. On change is a declarative rule. If you are using this particular activity as a part of on change declarative rule, then you have to use this activity type as on change. See, based on its particular, so there is one more something called as trigger, locate, load data page, asynchronous, assign, assembler, and activity. Okay. So all these are types. So based on its usage, you have to define the type of this particular activity. Based on its usage, you have to define the type of the activity. Okay, next. Now see here, if you wanted to run this activity, so in which class you can run this particular activity? You can impose privileges on your activities. So requires authentication to run. So the privilege class is this class. Now, if you wanted to run this particular class in a different class called as work to class, where you don't have the privilege, can you run this activity? No, you cannot run. So the privilege of your activity is at your class level. Only in your work class, as per the definition of this, it will only run in this particular work class. Okay. So these are main important points to be considered in terms of your interview point of view. Okay. So now, one more important point. I was telling you, you have to limit your activity steps to 25. Now, if my requirement is 100 steps, then what you have to do? You have to split. You have to split the activities into different steps. Say, for example, you wanted to, so there are 100 steps, right? You will split into 20, 20, 20, and you'll create 5 activities. And you'll call one activity from the other activity, right? You will call one activity from another activity. How to call an activity from another activity?
By method call.
Are using call. Is this the only option to call an activity from another activity?
We have branch and queue.
Yes, we have call, branch, and queue. So these are three different types where you can call one activity from another activity. Call, branch, queue. So this is not important in terms of your interview, but the differences between these three things is very, very important. They'll not ask you the number of ways to call an activity from another activity. They'll not ask you. So they'll ask you, what's the difference between call versus branch? What is call and what is the difference? See, call is used for the purpose of calling one activity from another activity. Branch is also used from, it is also used to call one activity from the other activity. Now, what's the difference?
It will execute, call will execute after executing the call, it will implement another functions in our activity. Whereas branch, it will not, it will exit out of that activity.
Okay. Correct. So the difference between call and branch is, now there is act one and there is act two. So you are running activity one. Okay. Step one, step two. So after step two, I am using call. Call ACT two. Now there is step three and step four. Now see here, in activity two, you have step one, step two. Okay. Very, very important in terms of your interview point of view. You will start running activity one. You have initiated execution of activity one. So in the first instance, it will execute step number one. After executing step number one, it will go to step number two. In this thing, so now after step number two, it is calling activity two. Now the control will go to where? It will go to activity two. And so till that point of time, your activity one is on hold. Okay, so it will not continue step number three and step number four. That is not the case. So your activity will stop execution. It will go to activity. That is, the control will go to activity two. It will execute step number one. It will execute step number two. Once step number two is completed, your activity two is completed. Once activity two is completed, it will come back to this parent activity. That is activity one. And it will start continue execution of step number three, step number four, and it will exit from this particular activity. Okay, so this is what your call means, which is very, very straightforward. Okay, now instead of call one, I've used branch. Now what happens? Step number one will be executed. Step number two will be executed. We have activity two call. The control will go to activity two. It will execute step number one. It will execute step number two. Now it will come back. Remember, it will come back to the parent activity. It will come back to this particular parent activity. And it will ignore these two steps, step number three step number four are ignored, and it will exit from the parent activity. Okay, so it will ignore all the steps after the branch, but the exit is from activity one. So why I'm stressing this point is because 90% of the people, what they'll do is they'll tell you something like this. It will come to activity two. Step number one is executed. Step number two is executed. After executing step number two, it will exit from the both the activities. It will exit from activity two. People think that it will not come back to activity one. People, 90% of the people will think that it will not come back to activity one. No, it is not the case. It will come back to activity one, and it will ignore the step number three, step number four are ignored. It will exit from the activity one. Now assume that branch ACT3, assume that there is one more activity three. Now once it comes back to activity one, now tell me, will it execute activity three or not? It will execute. It will ignore the steps, but it will not ignore the call steps. If you use call or branch, it will execute. It will execute activity number three. It will go to activity three. It will complete all the steps in activity three. It will come back. It will come back to activity one. If there are any steps, it will ignore. Again, I assume that there is one more branch, ACT4. If there is a call, branch call, then it will go to activity four. It will come back. So for that purpose only, it is coming back actually. If there are any other calls, branch related calls, to see whether it has any other branch calls or not, for that purpose, it is coming back. The reason why it is coming back is because if it is looking for if there are any other branches or any other calls to other activities, if there are any other activities to call, it will go and it will execute and it will come back. Only it will step, it will ignore the steps.
For example, if we have call and after step four, so will that execute it?
If you have call, it will go. It will go to the call and again it will come back. It will ignore. Still it will ignore. You got this difference between call and branch? Then what is queue? Queue as ACT2. What happens? So it will start execution. It will execute step number one. It will execute step number two. It will execute queue. It will go to activity two. The control will go to activity two. And now it's a parallel processing. Your activity one will not stop. It will not, it is not on hold. It will start executing step number three. Okay. Parallelly, activity two, step one is also executed. So it's a kind of parallel processing. Both activities, it will start, it will continue to execute. So this is what queue means. So these are three different calls on activities. So the difference between call and branch is very important. Okay. Now I'll give another scenarios. So now tell me. Steps, how it will execute. It will start executing activity one. It will go to step number one. It will go to step number two. It will go to call. It will go to activity two. Now the control will come to activity two. Now here I've used exit activity. There is a method called as exit activity. So if I use exit activity, what happens?
It will go back to activity number one.
It will go back to activity number one. It will exit this, and it will go to the parent activity. It will start executing step number three and step number four. Okay. Now, instead of exit activity, I've used another method called as activity hyphen end. Now what happens?
It will exit all. It will end at this step.
The thing is, it will exit from the activity two, and also it will exit from activity one also. Okay, this is the difference. This is also important in terms of your internal point of view. So exit activity. Now I've told you two things. One is exit activity and activity end. These are two things. So the definition of exit activity and activity end is, the difference is, it will exit only from the current activity and it will go back to the parent activity. Okay, so your parent activity will start execution process normally. Now if you come back to activity end, so it will exit from both the current activity and its parent activity. This is the difference between activity exit activity and activity end. Okay. Any questions? These are very, very basics and activities. Any questions so far on activities? Okay, we'll proceed. You want me to take, you want you to take some break, 5 minutes break? Hello?
Yeah, better.
Yeah. Just, I'll start again. Guys, still we have half an hour session. Okay, so just take 3 to 5 minutes of break and come back. I'll continue the session. Okay, we'll close activity and we'll leave for the day. Okay, thank you. So just to do 5 minutes break. Okay.
Okay. Yes, Karthik.
Yeah. So we'll continue further. So now it's about the methods. So I'll define what is a method. So every step in activity has some method. So method will define you what is the purpose of that particular step. So what actually happens is, so your activity will start executing step by step. At each and every step, it calls a method. So that method performs certain task and it is completed. Okay. So what is a method? A method is something which is already defined and placed in the system. So if I use page new, there is some specific purpose to page new method. So in page new, in the sense, in the background, it will create a page. That is, it will create a page in the clipboard and it is done. So every has certain task. So if you call that particular method, it will perform that particular task. Okay. So every step has certain method. So it will execute that method and it performs an action and it will go to the next step. This is how your activity structure is. Now we'll study about a few basic methods. One is page new. The first one is page new. Page new, in a sense, it will create a new page in the clipboard. If I use page new, it will create a page in the clipboard. So this is the name of the page in which for which it is going to create in the clipboard. So if you wanted to create a page, first of all, you have to define it, that page, in the pages and classes tab, because pages cannot exist without a class. Pages cannot exist without a class. Okay. And if you wanted to create any page in the activity, first of all, you have to define it and then you have to create it. Okay. And for activity, we have parameters. So parameters is of two types. One is in parameters and other one is out parameters. In parameters will serve as input for the activity. Out parameter is something, it is after executing your activity, it is giving some output from that particular activity. So the output is given in terms of parameters. Okay, this is all about parameters. So now there are a few methods. Page new, equivalent, we have page remove. Once you create a page in the clipboard, after that, after its usage, so it's user's responsibility to remove the page from the clipboard.
Sorry, so Karthik.
I'm sorry.
Can you repeat the part of the parameters?
Parameters, right? Okay.
Yes.
So assume that there is a task, something like this. I wanted to calculate some A equal to B plus, okay. Now what are the inputs? So I'm assume that I'm doing this logic in an activity, okay. So A equal to B plus C. I have I wanted to send these A, B, C as a parameters for this particular activity. So first param is A, second param is B, and third parameter is C. Okay. So what are B and C? B and C are input parameters or output parameters? They are input parameters because I wanted to take this as input for this particular activity. In the activity, I am performing this particular logic, A equal to B plus C. So B and C will serve as an input for this particular activity. I am providing values for this particular activity in terms of B and C. Now I'll pass B equal to some phi, C is equal to some n. Now it will, this activity has a logic. It will create A equal to B plus C. It will evaluate this expression and its value is calculated and it will return this value. So these two are input parameters. And what is the type of this parameter? It is output parameter. Output, these are inputs. How do I know that the parameters are input or output? Here, there is a type called as in out. If you keep in, so this will serve like as an input for the parameter. If you keep it out, it will serve as an output for the activity, output parameter. See, ultimately, this is only just a representation kind of thing. It's just a representation kind of thing. It has got nothing to do with the activity execution process. So what it will do is, it will simply evaluate this expression A equal to B plus C, and the value is stored in the A. That's it. But if you are trying to call this activity, so if I wanted to call this activity to get this done, so I should know, right, what kind of parameters I should pass for this particular activity and what is the expected result out of this activity. It is just a visual representation for the users. If I wanted to call this activity A equal to B plus C activity, so I have to pass some parameters, right? What parameters I'll pass? Only B and C parameters I'll pass because B and C are input parameters. And I'll expect value A from the activity, because it is out parameter. Okay.
Yes, okay.
Yeah. So parameters are something where you can pass some value, I mean, some kind of data to the activity. It can be passing the data or it can be getting the data also. So this is about parameters. So I was telling you page new method, right? We have page new. Similarly, we have page remove. Page new, what it will do is, it will create a new page in the clipboard. Page remove, what it will do is, it will remove a page from the clipboard. Okay, these are basic things. Next, other one is property set. What is property set? It will assign values to the properties. If you wanted to assign values to the properties, so you have to use properties, property set method. By using property set method, you can assign values to the properties. It can be a standalone properties, it can be a page properties, it can be page list properties, or it can be a page group properties. Ultimately, you are assigning values to the property. You can assign hard-coded values, or you can assign one property to another property also. That is also possible. This is about property set. Okay, next one. Now let's speak something about DB related methods, which are important. So generally, what kind of operations we'll do on database?
Create or update or delete.
Current operation, sir. Create, read, update, and delete. These are four basic operations that you will perform on a table. So create in the sense you're actually adding new rows to the table. Reading in the sense you are reading or browsing records from the table. Update in the sense you are actually updating a record in the table. Deleting in the sense you are completely removing the row from the table. So these are basically four operations that you can perform on a table. CRUD operations. So for CRUD operations, now here there are two things. Now the table might be an internal table, or the table might be an external table. There are two kinds of tables. One is an internal table, other one is an external table. If you wanted to update internal tables, you have to use OBJ methods. If you wanted to update external tables, you have to use RDB methods. Okay, you got this. If you wanted to update internal tables, you have to use OBJ browse, OBJ open, OBJ save, OBJ open by handle, OBJ delete, OBJ delete by handle. Generally, these were the methods which are supported. If you use RDB, it is RDB list, RDB open, RDB save, RDB delete. These are various operations which are supported for external tables. So if it is an internal one, you have to use OBJ methods. If it's an external one, you can use RDB methods. This is the first point you have to remember. Any questions so far? It's about internal table versus the external table. Now there is a question here. The question is, can I use RDB methods for calling internal tables? Okay, so the question is, I'm telling you, if you wanted to access internal tables, you have to use OBJ methods. If you wanted to call external tables, you have to use RDB methods. Now the question is, can I use RDB methods to call an internal table? Is it possible?
Yes.
Yes. We can use RDB methods in order to call internal tables also. It is by using RDB, it is calling external tables. It can also call internal tables also. Now, the vice versa. That is, can I use OBJ methods to call external tables?
No.
No, that is not possible. That is not possible. Okay. So RDB can perform both internal and external tables, but whereas OBJ, it will call internal only. Now, if I use for calling an internal table, if I use OBJ versus RDB, which is better performance? I'll tell you the difference. See here, OBJ, if you are using OBJ, what happens is the query which is generated to get the data from the table. So whatever the operation, if it is either update, read or delete, so ultimately it generates the code. If I use OBJ, system will generate that query. Okay. If I use RDB, who has to write this RDB query? User has to write this RDB query. This is the difference. Right? Now tell me, system has generated the query versus user has generated the query. Which one is better performance? You got this, I'll repeat it. If you use OBJ methods, right? I've used OBJ browse. So it is nothing but select star from so and so table that it will generate. Who will generate that? System will generate. If I use RDB, I will write select star from so and so table. So I will write this. As a user, I have to write this. Now tell me which one is better performance. RDB or better performance. RDB has better performance because you will try to fetch what you wanted to get. So if you use a system related query, right, it will bring all unnecessary data. First of all, it has to build the query, it has to generate, it has to look for many other validations also. There are many things which happens in the background. So for that reason, generally RDB methods are better performance than OBJ methods. But for internal tables, you will use OBJ methods only, not RDB methods. Okay, because the suggested one is to use OBJ because system is generated in the queries instead of RDB. RDB in the sense user has to write, right, those queries. So though it is OBJ or not better performance than RDB methods, PRPC still suggests to use OBJ methods for internal tables because system will generate the queries and it is not an overhead for the users. The ultimate goal of PRPC is what? It wanted to eliminate the coding process. User should not worry about the queries, writing all those structures. So system will generate that. So it suggests you use OBJ methods for internal tables. But comparing with these two things, RDB methods are better performance, has better performance. So these kind of questions you'll get in an interview. Okay. Now, do you know what are stored procedures? Stored procedures. What is a stored procedure? Now, any one of you are from database background?
Huh? Yes.
Yeah. Yes, Lalita, tell me. What is stored procedures?
I mean, stored procedure is a native code. When we call the procedure, it's executed in the database.
Yes. So these are native calls in a sense. You have list of queries instead of writing having a single query. So these are the list of queries or the instructions you will pass for on the database.
Yes.
So mainly if you wanted to have stored procedures, then you have to use RDB. You want to write some stored procedures on internal tables or external tables, then you have to use RDB methods only. So stored procedures is possible in RDB methods, not on OBJ methods. So this is another advantage that you have when you use RDB. Okay, next. So now we'll discuss. Now one more thing, let's find the differences between OBJ and RDB. OBJ browse is equivalent to RDB. Let's see this. Go to steps. RDB list. So your OBJ browse is equivalent to RDB list. So this is used for internal tables and this is used for external tables. Now tell me, what is OBJ browse? What is OBJ?
Database, I mean from table.
To get data from the table. Is it a single row or multiple rows?
I think multiple rows.
Yes. OBJ browse is used to fetch multiple rows from the table. Okay. It is multiple rows from the table. It's not a single row. OBJ browse is used for the purpose of fetching multiple rows from the table. Equivalently, if you use RDBList, RDBList is also used for the purpose of fetching multiple rows from the table. The only difference is OBJ browse is for internal table and RDBList is from external table. Okay. Now, where are these results stored? These results are stored in clipboard.
Clipboard.
In the clipboard. On which page it will store?
PX results.
PX results is the page list property. All your results are stored. Now, this PX results is in which class?
Code Pega list.
This is code dash Pega dash list is the class. It is an out of the box class. So this class, this particular class has something page list property called as PX results. So if you fetch multiple records, so all the records are stored in PX results page list property. So for that reason, whenever we use OBJ browse, right? So that OBJ browse, if you define a page, we define that page as a part of code Pega list class, because PX results is a part of code Pega list class. Similarly, in RDBList also, when you fetch multiple results, now in the clipboard, all your results are stored in PX results only. Okay, so next.
So, Karthik, I have one basic question here. Like, when you say internal table, you mean system defined table?
No. I did not mean. Okay. So basically, you wanted to know what is the difference between an internal table and an external table. Okay. So when you install PRPC, how many databases are there? We have seen, right? Two databases. One is Pega Rules. This is one database. Another one is Pega Data. These are two databases. I'll show you in the system. Go to app, sorry, go to records. So from the records, so your database rules comes under sysadmin category. So go to database. This Pega Data and Pega Rules are considered as an internal database. If you wanted to get the data from this Pega Data and Pega Rules database, you have to use OBJ methods. And if you create an external database, see here, there is something called as EXTDB. This is an external database which user has configured. So that database name is EXT database. So if you wanted to get the data from this particular database, then you have to use RDB methods. This is the difference. So when I say internal table means it is from either from Pega Data or Pega Rules. If I say external database means the configured database by the user. The database which are created by the user and they have configured this particular database. These are called as external database. So in that context, I'm speaking. Maybe I would have told this before I started this topic. Okay.
Yeah. Okay, got it. Thank you.
So now it is Pega Rules, Pega Database. Now, OBJ browse. Next one is OBJ open, RDB open. Now tell me, what is OBJ open?
It fetches the single record. something.
It will fetch a single record from the table. Similarly, we have RDB open. OBJ open and RDB open. If you are fetching a single record from the table, how is that possible? See, if I do a query, how can you guarantee me that it will fetch only a single record?
You have to.
I've done it.
Meta.
Yeah. Now my query is assume that select star from table one where status is equal to open. Can you guarantee me that this particular query will bring only one record?
No.
Now status is equal to resolved completed. Can you guarantee this for this particular query?
No.
No, here also you cannot guarantee. Then when will you guarantee that I'll get only a single record?
Where ID equal to something.
Mm-hmm. What is that ID? It is a class key. Yes. When class key is equal to some ABC. Now can you guarantee me that it will fetch only a single record?
When pzInsKey.
Okay, so pzInsKey is a different thing. I'll come back to that. Class key.
Or
class key is also unique within a table, right?
Yeah, within a table is unique.
Or we have to say fetch first one row only.
Fetch one row only. Okay, but you out of multiple results, it will give you one row. That's a different story. See. Fetch one row, what it will do is, if the results you got, assume that you got 10 results, it ultimately it will fetch you one row. That's not the one. The query should get only a single record. How will you guarantee that? Either you have to use pzInsKey, that is one way, and another way is using class key also, you can get a single record, right? See, within the table, class key is unique. I'm querying single table. Within a table, if I pass class key or pzInsKey, both the things. So is it guaranteed that I'll get only a single record or not? See, ultimately, yeah. My goal is to get a single record. How will you ensure that I'll get a single record?
By passing key value.
Yes, passing key value. So the key might be a class key or it can be a pzInsKey also. Can be either a class key or pzInsKey. So now, if I pass class key, then it is OBJ open. If I pass pzInsKey, it is OBJ open by handle. See, if you pass class key, okay, then it is called as OBJ open. If you have pzInsKey in your hand, then you have to use OBJ open by handle. This is the difference. OBJ open and OBJ open by handle, both are used for the purpose of fetching a single record. Similarly, come to RDB open. Now tell me, For external tables, pzInsKey is generated, or see, ultimately pzInsKey is generated by the system. If this is an external table, will pzInsKey make sense for external table? Will it have that particular column?
No,
it will not have. So for external tables, there is no concept of pzInsKey. So for that reason, we don't have RDB open by handle. We don't have that method in for external tables. Okay. We only have one method, that is RDB open. RDB open will take class key as input. Okay. Similarly, obj open will take class key, obj open by handle will take pzns. This is the difference. Now, if you wanted to delete obj, delete rdb, delete obj, delete by handle. These are also a single record operations. If you wanted to delete a record, okay, by using class key, we use obj delete, and you have to pass class key as a filter criteria. If you wanted to delete a single record, if you have pzInsKey in hand, you are aware of pzInsKey, then obj delete by handle is the best one. Similarly, rdb delete you have to use in order to delete your row from the external table. Now, which one is most performant? Is it obj open versus obj open by handle? Obj delete versus obj delete by handle? Which has more performance? If you have class key and pzInsKey both in your hands, assume that you have class key information and also pzInsKey information. So which one will you use? You will use obj open or obj open by handle? Which one you have to use?
Obj open by handle.
By handle. You have to use always by handle because it's a direct database hit. It's a direct one. So it's a hard query data it generates. And if it is an open, it will open. It is delete, it will delete. So always, if you have pzInsKey, go with by handle methods, either obj open by handle or obj delete by handle. Right? Next. Next one is obj safe. Here it is rdb safe. Save is used in two contexts. You can update an existing rule or you can create a new rule. Yeah, saved as two options. It can update an existing row, or it can create a new row in the table. So for these two purposes, we use obj safe or rdb safe. Okay, now, so obj safe will not actually save into the database. So it has a temporary location called as defer queue. If you say obj save, I did row one. So now row one will go to defer queue list. Row one will go to defer queue. It is not yet updated in the table. Okay. If you wanted to update in the table, what you have to do? You have to use a method called as commit method. Commit, what it will do is it will take this row and it will commit to the data table. So now it is updated in the table. Unless you do a commit operation, so it will not commit into the table. Now, why we are using defer queue? Why not obj save will directly save into the table? Why we have to save it in a defer queue temporary location? Only on commit you are actually committing into the table. Why we need all these things? Hello. So these are interview questions. Why we need to have defer queue? Why not it saves directly into the table? What is the point in having the defer queue? Hello. Say for example, you are writing a Word document. You wanted to undo the changes. What will you do? You will do a control Z operation so that it will undo, it will come to the previous state. Right? See, if you are composing something on the Word document, you have written line 1, line 2, line 3. There are three lines. After line number 2, you have saved. And you have written line number 3. Now you wanted to go back to the previous state. If you type Control Z, it will go back to the previous state. That is, it has only two lines. See, once it is saved, it is saved. You cannot do anything. In order to roll back, so what we are doing is we have brought defer queue concept into the picture. If there are any errors and you wanted to, during your save operation, you have encountered some errors. Okay. Now you wanted to roll back. You wanted to go back to the previous state. So once, if the data is committed into the table, you cannot roll back. Till if it is the, if the rows are updated in defer queue, you can roll back. In the sense, you can go back to the previous state. So for that reason, what it is doing is to just to make sure that unless and until you commit the, it will not commit. Unless and until you commit the data, it will not commit. You have to mention it and commit, then only it will go and it will store in the table. Otherwise, it will not store. So if you wanted to uncommit your changes, what you will do? Instead of using commit, you have to use roll back. Once you do a roll back, what happens is it will remove, it will discard the changes from the defer queue. It will discard the changes, whatever the changes which are written in the defer queue, it will simply discard those rows from the defer queue. Okay, and rollback is used, say for example, you have written row 1, row 2, row 3. No, now all this list came and sat in defer queue. Row 2 and row 3. You have done OBJ save on three rows, that is row 1, row 2, and row 3. So these three rows and came and sat in defer queue. Now, if you use rollback, it will discard all these three rows. Now, if you use, instead of OB rollback, if I use OBJ save cancel, then what happens? It will only discard the latest item from the defer queue. Rollback is a multi-row operation. OBJ save cancel is a single row operation. This is the difference between rollback and OBJ save cancel. Now, with RDB save, can I use commit? Yes, you can use commit. You have to use commit in order to commit the changes. And if you use rollback, that also will discard the changes from the defer queue. If you use OBJ save cancel, it will discard a single row from the defer queue. And if you use commit, it is a multi-row operation. What about the list of pending items which are there in the defer queue? It will go and commit all the rows into the table. Now, OBJ save has one more option. OBJ save has right now operation. I'll use row 1 with option right now. What happens if I use right now? So there is no concept of defer queue now. It will directly go and save in the table. No picture of defer queue, commit, all those operations. It is a direct database or a table commit operation. If you use right now, the row will go and it will sit in the table. Once you use right now, you cannot roll back the changes. So that depends on your requirement. When to use right now, when not to use right now. So generally, we should not use right now. Okay. So most of the times, you should not use right now. You have to use OBJ save followed by the commit operation. Okay. So this is all about your OBJ save, OBJ methods. Any questions so far?
Karthik, can you repeat for OBJ save cancel?
OBJ save cancel. Okay, fine.
I'll take an example. So this is obj save operation, and I have I'll remove all this things. This is obj save, this is defer queue, and this is table, actual table where you wanted to store. Now I have done obj save row 1. What will happen? It will go, I'm not using any right now operation, okay? So it will go and it will sit in row in the defer queue. So still table was not yet updated. Okay, now if I use commit operation, what happens? This row will go and it will sit in the table. Okay, now instead of using commit, I'll do obj save, I will use row 1. Now instead of using commit operation, I have done rollback. What happens with the rollback? It will simply discard the changes from the list, defer queue list. Okay, now instead of using one row, I have used two rows, row 1 and row 2. What happens? Obj save row 1 will do row 1 in defer queue. Obj save row 2 will write row 2 in the defer queue. Now I wanted to discard two items from the defer queue, or simply all the items from the defer queue. What should I use here? Rollback will discard all the list of items which are there in the defer queue. Okay, it will discard all the rows. Okay, now instead of using rollback, I will use obj hyphen save hyphen cancel. Now what this will do? It will discard only a single item from the defer queue, a single row from the defer queue. Which row? Row 1 or row 2? The latest row. What is latest row here? The row 2, right? So it will discard this one. I'm telling you, rollback will discard all the list of items, uncommitted things which are there in the defer queue. If I use obj save cancel, what it will do is it will discard the latest single record from the defer queue. Now if I wanted to discard this one also, again you have to use obj save cancel again. If I use this one again, it will remove this one. It is a obj save cancel is a single record operation in the defer queue. This is what I'm saying. This is the difference between rollback and obj save cancel. Rollback will discard multiple rows from the defer queue. Obj save cancel will discard a single row from the defer queue. Got the difference?
Yeah, yes, cut. Okay.
So now all these operations are applicable for RDB also. All these operations are applicable even for RDB methods. Any other questions, or do you want me to repeat any other methods? Okay. So still we have many questions in activities. Okay. Because by using activity, you can call n number of other rules. If you wanted to call decision table, okay, property map decision table, you have to use. If you wanted to call a decision tree, property map decision tree. If you wanted to call validate methods, you can call it via activity. If you wanted to call validate methods, you can use obj validate, edit validate. All these methods you can call it via activity also. Okay. These are the basic things. Okay. Still, we have some advanced questions on activities also. Okay. So maybe that will take in our next session. Okay. So today I think we are done with only the basics part of activities.